So we just started the YouTube stream. We are live right now. Let's go to our three shot. We're just doing a quick pre-show right now, just to make sure everything is working as they promised it should. Never does, but hey, we try. Here we go. So that's all three of us here. We've got Hugh Brownstone in the position of importance, right in the middle. And then we've got Jeff Blanchard, a good friend and co-host.
Good morning, afternoon.
In Melbourne, Australia. It's early your time, isn't it? About 8 or 9?
No, 10 o'clock.
Oh, 10 o'clock. Okay.
When it's winter, it's 8 o'clock. It's early, so.
And we'll be changing soon, about another a little over a month. And so we're just going to go. So in our live, we're just going to go through these shots real quick, make sure everything is good and it looks good. Everybody there, we'll go to this shot. We're going to start on this shot.
Start on this one and then do the intro.
Okay, so we're going to do a very short pre-show because we've already kind of pre'd ourselves. So
yes,
we're going to start the show recording then in 3, 2, and 1. Hi, everyone. Welcome to Tech Down Over. I am joined today by my good friend and co-host, Jeff Blanchard. How are you, Jeff?
Good, thank you, Rick. I'm really excited for our very special guest we've got today.
Yeah, it should be really fun. His name is Hugh Brownstone. He is a lot of things. He owns a production company called Three Blind Men and an Elephant Productions. And we'll show that to you in a moment. And he's a videographer, a photographer, a scriptwriter, a lot of things. Plus, his blog posts and his reviews are great. They're really fun to listen to, and
certainly are.
We enjoy him, and we liked it so much. We had him invited, and he actually accepted. So there is a flaw in him. He actually accepted this, but we'll get by that. Anyway, here we go. And there he is. He just joined us right in the middle position. Hugh Brownstone. Hey, Hugh, how are you today?
Hey, guys. I'm fine. I've got one ear out for my golden retriever, who I just let out of the house, and we'll see if she creates havoc for me.
Well, goldens are fun dogs, so she should be fine.
They are, but they shed incredibly. And this is the single biggest problem I have with the 27-inch 5K iMac. I can see her hair on my shirts during. I give up. I just can't get it off. So fortunately, most people don't have that kind of screen, and they're watching things on a phone or a tablet. But it's annoying.
That's funny. But dogs are great. They're fun to have. We have two dogs too, and they're girls, and they shed all. One's a collie, and one is a German Shepherd collie mix, which is sort of interesting. And they shed 360. Every day is just shedding. And then when you cut their hair, they shed some more because they grow it very quickly.
So, a Furminator just makes it worse.
The Furminator. Actually, we have one of those. It works.
Yeah, it does. It does. I grew up with a Shepherd, and my daughters grew up with a Shepherd. They're fantastic dogs.
They are.
But after our second Shepherd, it was a different set of circumstances, and a Golden is the right way to go. Yep. She's great. Sophie
Goldies.
Is great.
Goldies are friendly. They're fun.
They are.
and actually, Jeff has a dog. He's got a pointer.
I must say, because I said the English pointer, and he insists on sleeping next to the desk while I'm doing these podcasts. He won't accept being out, or else he'll cry and back. But the only thing is, sometimes when the shot's not on me, people think I'm snoring and having a little bit of a sleep, because he tends to have a little bit of a snore. So it's, if you do hear that, it's not me. I'm interested in what you're saying. So.
Okay.
Now, Hugh, in one of your podcasts, you said, I'm new to podcasting, and I finally decided to go on my own and do this. What did you do before?
Well, I don't know how far you want to go back, but...
We have an hour, so no. We have whatever much you need.
Well, I actually spent a decade on Wall Street as a senior executive for a global Fortune 500 institution, and then went to pharmaceutical market research, and at some point... I decided I did not want to do that anymore. And over time, and a couple of startups, I figured out that what actually made me happy And I found this out on the last startup before this production company, was actually shooting little product videos on my 5D Mark II.
Hmm.
And I'd reached that point in my life where I could retire. So I did that. And one day I was on Planet 5D, which I like very much. It's one of my go-to sites. And Mitch Onger, Planet Mitch, popped up in a chat session. And we started texting away, and I said, how come no one's talking about downsizing from a 5D Mark II to something like a pair of little Rebel SL1s? Mm. I mean, they're at least as good video cameras. It gives you more money, frees up more money to do other things. And he says, well, no one's doing that. And I said, I did it. He said, you want to write about it? I said, okay. And a couple of months later, he asked me to start writing for him, and I wrote for Planet 5D pretty much daily, over 300 posts over the next year and a half. And at that point, it was time to actually take a walk on the wild side and do it on my own. But Mitch and I remain good friends, and every now and again, he'll post some of the stuff that I do.
Now, from being on Wall Street and doing pharma, how did you learn your art of photography and video? And I love your, when I watch your podcasts, I love one thing you say all the time. It doesn't matter how good your gear is, it's what you do, it's about the people. And that's so true. That's so true.
So I got my start. I was very fortunate. My parents were, my father has died, my mother is still alive, and she is just a force of nature. She's going to be 85 this year. But she had a Leica 3A. In fact, and when you're kind of 7 or 8 years old, you look at that and all you want to do is take it apart. It's just such a beautiful piece of machinery. All you want to do is take it apart. You don't know what it does. And I took it apart. I actually spray painted it black. I didn't ask my mother if I could do that. And I filled in the Leica thing with white chalk because I thought that would look better. She didn't get mad at me. She had it repaired. But that camera presented me with the first image that I'd ever seen from a 35 millimeter camera. It was a Kodachrome slide, a photograph that she had taken at the shore of driftwood. And I was transfixed by it. Yeah. And that's how it got started. By the time I was 12, I wanted to get a 35 millimeter camera. I mean, I went through my Sears Instamatic 126, yep. Period. and just loved it. My father supported me. He says, if you can come up with half, I'll come up with the other half. And I bought a Canon FTQL. And by the time I was 16, I was running the photography program at a summer camp up in Maine. I had my own darkroom. You guys, I'm sure you remember things like Vessler 23C and Schneider Compagnon lenses and D76 and Accufine. Hey, if you were really hip, you would push Tri-X from 400 to 1200 by using Accufine. So I was really into it. And after that, it receded to just be something that I enjoyed doing. I kept buying cameras as life events changed. So I ended up with a Canon F1, and then when the EOS system came out, to the EOS 3 with iFocus. I don't know if you guys remember that.
I remember that, yeah.
One of the cameras that I did not get, and most people don't even realize that the Sony A99 is not, by a long shot, the first Pellicle SLR. In fact, I recall the Canon Pellicle QL, which also had a silvered mirror. And then when I had kids, I switched over to auto exposure and eventually autofocus because it took too much time to catch the little rugrats with a regular camera. And then when the five, I played with video, but before that, actually, there was a single 8. You guys remember the difference between single 8 and super 8?
No, I remember the super 8, and single 8, I think, was a little bit bigger on the film.
So Fuji did the single 8. That came after super 8. And my father had bought, it was a fixed lens or maybe a small zoom lens, P1 or something like that. And I made my first film, and it was my last film for a very long time when I was 13 or 14, called Boney and Klutz. And you can imagine that that was a takeoff or inspired by Bonnie and Clyde. It was terrible, really terrible. except for one scene where my 7-year-old sister and my, or maybe 10-year-old sister and 13-year-old friend, best friend, Lloyd Handworker, were Bonnie and Clyde, and they were driving in the driveway with the car not moving. But somehow we got the camera movement going, and that was really exciting. By the way, Lloyd ended up taking filmmaking much more seriously than I did, and he eventually directed Famous Nathans, which premiered at Tribeca 2 years ago. That was outstanding.
So you've pretty much seen it all as it's gone from the DSLRs from the SLRs to the DSLRs, and fun. My background's not as long as yours. My dad was into cameras, and I think he had that Leica, and my mom was always the Instamatic person. She's about 2 years younger than your mom, but my dad was into the Hasselblads and the Insta, and he had them all, the Raleigh Flex, and he had one Nikon that he loved. I don't remember what number that was. It was an SLR, and it was heavy. It was really felt nice, but he wouldn't let me touch him much. I don't get away from that. It's like, can I play with it? No. I got more into it, really more in the digital. When it went digital, I started getting more into it. But I was into the video before that. You know, we did our typical Super 8s. And then when digital video really came out, we jumped on it. It was something. And as a company, we jumped on it back in the late 1990s. And we've loved it ever since. It's fun. And I just love when you talk about the cameras and how they've really evolved to what we have now. A lot of people, there's some magic about the old cameras and what they do, but the new ones are pretty magical too in a different way. And it's amazing what they do, though.
This is insanity.
Yeah.
This is insanity. I in my 2016 annual review, I named computational imaging the technology of the year, as embodied in the Apple iPhone 7 Plus. You guys, I'm sure, are aware that there are other people trying to do that. Apple actually acquired Lynx, which was doing multi-sensor lens combos. And Light, with their L16, is at the forefront of that. But there have been delays in shipping. I mean, it's natural when you're working with something so new.
But now, there's several cameras that are doing that now with the multiple lenses. I think Huawei and a couple of others are doing. I'm not sure if LG is. They may be.
Huawei, you remember that story with their, what is it, the P9 or H9 or whatever it was?
I think it was the 9, the Honor 9 or something like that.
Yeah, they did a shot which turned out was not from the Huawei, but from a Canon 5D Mark III or something.
I didn't know that. That's good. That figures. Yeah. Marketing gone awry, right?
Yeah.
Hey, let's take a shot with this Honor 9, but it doesn't work well, so let's use the 5D. That's perfect. Gotta love it. They got caught on that one, huh?
Now, Hugh, believe it or not, before about 3 or 4 weeks ago, I'd never seen any of your podcasts, and I thought, how could I have lived without seeing them? But I happened to be interested in the GH5, so my first view of one of your vlogs was your 4-minute thing of the GH5. I loved the content, but what I even loved better was just how you do your videos, because I was just mesmerized by just you walking along. And when you do videos, you just watch, seeing how steady the shot was and how the camera person's not running into anybody and how that's all working. And I think you did that on an iPhone, didn't you?
Well, we did. And I have Claudia to thank for that. My partner, my fiance, my camera op. She has no problem walking backwards in the middle of Manhattan on the High Line with the DJI Osmo and the 7 Plus. And the thing of it is, I really have to give her credit, because she knows how to walk to minimize this kind of movement. That's not something that the Osmo handles all that well, but it was just tremendous. And Jeff, I got a bunch of comments from people saying, I like the content, but holy crap, you shot it. And one person said, did you really do that? You know, are you green screening it? And I have to tell you that back here, we put it up on the display and we're going, that kind of looks like 1950s, early 1960s rear projection, because it looks like I'm walking on a treadmill.
It does. You know what's funny? I thought you had, I was going, I wonder if he green screened that. That's awfully stable. And I was going, what the heck is he doing with that? Now, I never would have guessed. Now, both Jeff and I have Osmos, so we know what they're like, and they're incredible. Your wife is incredible walking backwards like that. And you guys were walking for a bit, and it was really clean. It was absolutely clean.
I really don't know that I could have gotten it better with a long-term camera op, you know, a Steadicam operator. Yeah. Really, it was just incredible. And we were really excited. We were so excited. We immediately did another one while we were there on the Sony 70-200 F4, yep, which is a fantastic lens, a lens that I had not rated when I first came across it, but will probably end up in my arsenal.
Now, you're using the A6300 on a lot of the videos you do, correct?
Yes, the A6300 is now my A camera. Okay. The A6000, which I got in 2014 or early 2015, is my B camera. And there have been times, ever since I traded down from the 5D Mark II to the pair of SL1s, I've wanted to have two cameras because I wanted that second angle, specifically in interviews. And actually, I shouldn't call them interviews because they're really conversations. That's important to me. So the A6000 and the A6300 were both being used, for example, when I sat down with Juan Martinez and we talked about the announcement of the Sony FS7 Mark II. And these are such small cameras. They're so easy to set up. You don't need a big tripod. In fact, the A6300, I think, was on a Benro monopod. That's how light these things are.
Yep.
When I sat down with Paul Clayson for Hasselblad's X1D announcement, same setup, 6000 and a 6300, and super light tripods. I actually, my go-to tripod for that scenario is a Gitzo Mountaineer.
Mm-hmm.
Fiber.
Yeah,
the head is heavier than the whole set of sticks.
Oh, I believe it. Now, but the video quality on your 6300, as I watch, I was going, you know, that's damn good. Your eyes are so sharp on those. It just looks great. And I was going, because I was wondering at first, what's he shooting with? Trying to figure out what camera you want, if it was a DSLR, if it was a small one, a big one. And when he said 6300, I went, that's pretty good. It was clean.
It's ridiculous. It is officially ridiculous, especially when the lens. So that's a $1,000 camera.
Yeah.
But it's even more ridiculous because it's a $250 lens. It's Sony's E, so APS-C coverage only.
Yep.
50 millimeter, 1.8 OSS. So it has image stabilization.
Nice.
And this Sony review that's coming up next, I had the opportunity to play with the 55mm 1.8, which is extraordinary. I'll tell you how extraordinary in a minute. And the brand new Baby G Master, the 50mm 1.4.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the $250 E gives up very, very little.
Yeah.
It gives up something, and it was interesting because I did a review of a teleprompter where I used the 6300 and the 55 1.8, and when I first put the footage up on the screen, I did a double take because it was noticeably sharper than the little E, and I actually didn't think that was possible.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. I think you did some talk. You talked about Sigma too, didn't you? The 50s and...
Yeah, so
I've got about four Sigma lenses, and I'm just, they're heavy, they're big, but they really look good. as compared to other Canon 50s I got and 50s in the Micro Four Thirds line. They're pretty amazing.
They are amazing. I have a couple of buds, Max Uriev for one. He loves the 18-35 mm-hmm. and the 50-100. Jordan Drake, who was on your show with Chris Nichols from Camera Store TV, Jordan also loves that pairing. Yeah. I'm a little bit different. I think the 18-35 is too long for me on the short end on a crop sensor body. I really want 24 millimeter full frame equivalent on the wide end.
Okay.
So that's kind of 16 millimeters. That's really what I want. I perceive the difference. And I like small and light.
Yeah.
So this was what's really so interesting about the GH5 and my 2016 camera of the year, which is the little GX85, which again is a $600 camera. And no, it doesn't have a headphone jack. And no, it doesn't have a mic jack. But I don't care because, as far as I'm concerned, there's no camera that has onboard audio worth anything other than scratch.
True.
So I went out and got a GX85, and I got the Sigma 30mm 1.4. This lens, I think it was episode 2 of the GH5 Has Me Thinking, was shot on that.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And it weighed nothing.
Yeah.
Nothing to the Sony combo. But it has to be said that this is when lighting becomes important, because I light, and I was able to shoot that segment at ISO 200. So
nice.
Yeah.
And what are you lit with right now?
So right now I have an aperture 120T. That's okay. a tungsten balance.
Yep.
Single point LED, which is what most people would refer to as hard lighting. But the thing that I love, well, first of all, I really like Aperture's products. I really like the people in the company. I mean, I like them. So what's sitting on top of this is that it's got a Bowens mount. And this is the thing that most LEDs panels just can't do. You can't just pop on a grid or pop on a diffuser. I mean, they're out there, but they're not that much bigger than the surface area of the LED itself. Well, right now I have the light dome from Aperture, which takes a point source, which is, you know, this big, and makes it about 3 feet across.
Interesting. You know, Curtis,
it's sitting about 3 feet from my head.
You know, Curtis Judd was on last week, and he was talking about that same light and how much he really loves it.
Yeah.
He was surprised. He goes, I just love this light. And it's not cheap. What is it, about $600, $700? But it's darn good
light. It's so versatile.
Yeah, very versatile.
It is versatile.
And I like the look it gives you. It gives you a very nice look. Like, for example, I'm using right now blenders, the low blenders. And I've got two on me, and you're probably familiar with the blender. It basically combines. You can go to any color, somewhere between 3200 and about 5500 Kelvin, and we have it probably a little on the warmer side than the cooler side, but and they're almost at the lowest they can be, because if I bring them up, I'm blind. I mean, they're blinding. It's like a laser light. The same thing, and I think Jeff's got an Aperture or something similar on his end, but yeah, I love that 120T. It just has a really nice, soft, and yet pretty sharp. The light's so sharp; it's not dull. It just has a nice look to it.
Real natural.
Yeah, I like that look, and plus, I also like the darker backgrounds that you've got. And that's one thing I've always liked when you do your podcast. Some of the background lighting you have, it just looks great.
Always enjoy that. But you know, we've all been around long enough to know that it's never just the camera, it's never just the lens, it's never just the lighting. There was this is a great thing. I heard recently this joke. It's a variation of joke that many of us have heard. So it goes something like this guy comes into a Ducati dealership, and the Ducati is $16,000, and he says, what are you charging $16,000 for? I can go next door to another brand and get a bike with the same power and specs for $8,000. And the guy says, well, it's $8,000 for the motorcycle and $8,000 to know how to turn it into a Ducati. Now, yeah. I ain't no Ducati, but I understand and agree with the sentiment, which is that you can have all the gear in the world, and if you don't know how to use it, there's no point. And the thing about all of this gear is it's so complicated. It's almost impossible to move on to another camera, especially, and say, I'm ready to move on to another camera because I've truly mastered this one.
Yep.
I only figured out today, that if I use face registration on the A6300, and if I register my face, and Claudia helped me do that, that I can set the camera on autofocus when I'm doing these things. And I can go back and forth and side to side, and I will never be out of focus.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. And it'll even talk to you maybe and say, hey, Hugh, how are you? Let me get you in focus. They're amazing. And you know, that's where the Micro Four Thirds, I think, has it up over some of the big DSLRs. They have very good face recognition and the eye recognition, the eye focus. It's pretty darn amazing. The Panasonics do a great job of that. I think probably even better than the Olympuses. I've had about four different Panasonics, and they've all been really sharp at the focus. Not that good at tracking yet.
No.
Not that good at tracking, though. I'm hearing that the GH5 is much better at it. And the Fujifilms, which are, again, they're not Micro Four Thirds, they're APS-C, but they've done something that I think is incredible, and that's reproduce, I think, better color than Canon, which has probably the best color in the industry. And they, I think, are equal or better. And I just sit there going, wow, that's just amazing. When I shoot, I'll often look this way, look up, look back, and go, it's exactly the same. So what you're seeing and what you're filming, when you take the shot, my God, they get those strange purples right before sunset. They get the lights that other cameras just don't. And I'm amazed by some of that, just how well they've done. Now, I don't like, I think we talked a little bit about this. I'm not crazy about the ergonomics on the Fujifilm X-T2, for example. We have two of them. And I just go, it's good. I like it. Do I love it? No. I like it. I hate the menus. I'm getting older. I can't read the damn menus. They're really, everything's uppercase. Why don't you make it less uppercase? It's so damn hard to read their small fonts for me. I just find it irritating. And I'm not that used to having all the numbers on the dials on top. To me, it's cute, but I find it harder to read on the back because they use very small, it looks like a 4-point font what they're using. So I have to have my glasses on. If I don't have my glasses on, I'm kind of struggling. So you have to feel the top, but the top is also many times combined with other things. So you've got your shutter speeds, and then you've got other things on it. And you just go, wait a minute, where am I? Did I just skip over? I just went past the shutters. Now I'm... So those are irritants. But from a production point of view and the color you get, wow. And the picture quality and sharpness, it's beautiful.
I have to get my hands on it. The thing that's intriguing to me about the Fuji is the idea that it is simple to bake in a very finite number of looks.
Yes.
Not have to struggle. You know, some people like my bud Doug Jensen, he loves color grading. And he's a professional camera operator and DP. I mean, that's his full-time thing, beyond being an educator. So he loves doing that. I loved being in the darkroom, but at this stage of my life, I don't enjoy having to do a lot in post. I really want to bake it in. So right. S-Log, these are, and other log approaches, they are not as intriguing to me at all. Yep. As what Fuji can bake in.
Yeah,
guys, let me just take a time out for a second. Is it possible during a live broadcast for me to zip out for about 15 seconds?
Oh,
because
sure.
My dog is barking like crazy. I don't know if you can hear it.
You don't hear him. Yeah, we don't hear him. We don't hear her, but go ahead. No. Go ahead. Well, yeah. Jeff and I will dance.
All right.
That's right. But Rick, it was just quite interesting what you were saying about the face focus. I was watching one of the videos that he was doing from the A6500 release.
Oh,
and,
okay.
And And obviously that was that's on his 6300. As I said, I was just quite amazed because the autofocus kept picking up people in the background and focusing in on that. But it just really amazed me. It was very dull lit, the area where there was filming, but the quality was spot on. And when it focused on the background, you could see perfectly a monitor in the background with everything that was showing on
amazing.
That. But it's
now I do like the Sony shooting. I mean, the picture quality is pretty incredible. I'm just not crazy. I think my biggest concern with Sony is really the ergonomics.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Other than that, I like him. Oh, Hugh's back. Let's get him back on.
Thanks for that. The thing about the Sony, with every camera, I mean, we know this. With every camera, there are trade-offs.
Sure.
And I made the decision that I was willing to trade off ergos for ultimate image quality and price.
The price because is pretty price. Amazing on some of those. I mean, the 6300 at, what is it, about 1,000?
Yeah.
That's a steal.
It is a steal.
Now it has some issues. Like, I think they blew and they still have the heating issues and all that on 4K. But, you know, you don't need 4K for everything. So, as long as you don't go into 4K, it's perfectly good at 1080p.
I want 4K for everything.
So do I, because you can edit better with it.
and the reason why is because, as a still photographer, I know what sharpness is. And you can get more sharpness going from 1080p to 4K than I think you can going from a consumer grade lens in 1080p to a very expensive cine lens in 1080p. I mean, it's that big of a difference. That's my supposition.
You know,
take a good lens, take a really good lens and put it in 4K. It doesn't, it's not even something that most of my clients will see, but I see it. And I don't want to put in this much effort and not see something crystal coming back at me.
Yeah. Now, you edit in Final Cut Pro?
I do. And there's a lot of DaVinci Resolve shaming going on. People are saying, you know, if you're going to be a real editor, you need to go into Resolve. And or a real colorist.
Colorist.
My response is multi-threaded. Number one, I have no ambition to be a real colorist. I don't have enough time left in my life. I have a lot of time. I'm not terminal, but I'm just saying that there are so many other things that I want to do that I would much rather work with a great colorist at the point at which I need one. And the fact is, for what I do, I don't need one.
Yeah.
The second thing is that Final Cut Pro, I understand if you came from Final Cut 7 and then went over to X, you could say, the heck with this. But I went through a period, I started with iMovie. And that's how recent this is for me. So I
which
cut one, over
which
to
one
Final
did you
Cut
start
Pro.
With? Which
it was
one?
Very natural. And for a while, people were saying, oh, you have to be in Adobe Premiere. So I had the monthly the monthly fee for Adobe Premiere. And I did a video, which I really enjoy. The audio was not very good, but the rest of it I really, really liked. It was for a local guitar teacher. Two cameras set up, actually the 5D Mark II and a GH2. I had a GH2 for a while. And I learned they're kind of the same, at least for what I'm going to do. I'm never going to get to the 99th percentile or percentage of capability. I'm never going to be either an After Effects or a motion guru. It's just not what I'm going to be. And the last thing is on an Apple, which is all you can run Final Cut Pro on, the software screams. It screams. It blows away DaVinci. It blows away Adobe Premiere for that kind of thing. And the other thing that I'll say is, it has always been the case for me that Apple support has been stellar. So...
And I mean, I find with Final Cut Pro, the current version, well, the Final Cut 10, it's been out how many years now? And one purchase of it, and they've been upgrading, but not $1 extra.
Yeah, it's been at least, what, four or five years? At least 4 years.
$2.99 it cost it originally, and that's all I've ever paid for it. But it's, I came from, well, started with Final Cut Pro in the earlier version, but I gave up on them because I didn't like them that much. But it always amazes me with when people saying about Final Cut and Premiere. Premiere keeps coming out with slightly different features that trying to emulate what it does in Final Cut. So, but I do find you can do lots of things quite quickly. If you're like myself, I'm not a top-end editor, but I can get things done quite quickly and make it look quite decent.
Well, you know, Larry Jordan, who does a lot of video training, and he's always involved in just a lot of things with CES and NAB and everything else, he made a good point about Final Cut. He goes, there's going to be two camps in this world, the visual and the non-visual. Final Cut is visual. And that's what I like about Final Cut. It's very visual. It reminds me more of like a Sony Vegas when I was using that a lot. It's just a nice editor in that respect in terms of visual. You're not doubting what you're seeing. And even the way you choose your effects and everything, it's very clean, very visual. Premiere, on the other hand, sucks. I mean, I'm sorry, it doesn't suck. It's very non-visual. It hasn't changed all that much in the last 200 years it's been out. It just it's not my favorite. I learned how to edit on Adobe Premiere, and it's okay. And the people who loved Premiere, Final Cut 7 and 6, which I owned and hated because it was just like Premiere, because it came from Premiere. People forget that. The guy who wrote Premiere went to Apple and wrote Final Cut Pro. Final Cut Pro, yeah, 6 and 7.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, and that's why it's so crappy. And yet, the reason the editors, a lot of them, loved it so much is, one, you can make more money on it because it was hard to use and it was a pain in the butt. And two, they were used to it. So now you got to train somebody in something new. They get irritated. Is it great or good? I've done videos in Premiere that were okay. It was a pain to do. It took forever. I've done them in Final Cut Pro 7. With Final Cut Pro 7 and 6, guys who really knew their stuff, took them forever. And then I would come in with Sony Vegas, you know, which was a good indie type film too. And I was doing the same thing they were doing in 2 weeks in about 2 days. And they're going, how the heck did you do that? I go, it was easier. And when Final Cut Pro came out, even though everybody hated it because it looked more like, what was it, iMovie? But you know what? It did a lot of stuff. And then you had some great effects for it. You had FX Factory and a whole mess of other people creating really nice stuff for it. And it's hard to beat. And FX Factory works on Premiere and works on that. Premiere has made a lot of money recently because a lot of the Apple guys went over to it because they could not give up the Final Cut Pro 6 and 7 look. I was glad when they went away. I said, 6 and 7 gone? Good. Let me look at 10 here. And while it's not my favorite editor per se, I like it. I like the way it looks. Jeff does a good job with Final Cut Pro 10. And I've played with Resolve. And like you, I kind of like it. I think as an editing tool, it reminds me a lot more of Vegas without quite all the features. It's very similar in some approaches. I like it, but I find it kind of really teeny weeny fonts again. Here we go again. Why do I need to be blind to work on this thing? And I'm not a colorist, so when I look at color, I go, I don't want to go there. I don't have time. I want to spend the rest of my life just like you, just enjoying it, not trying to figure out every color in the world. And I'm not good at low contrast grays. So everything when you're coloring, something starts off gray. I'm like, oh, I can't even see this. I bought the Canon C100 Mark II when it came out. And I returned it within 2 days. And my sales rep got, what are you doing? I said, I can't see this thing. It's all gray. The whole thing is gray. The viewfinder is gray. What comes out is gray. I don't have time for this. I can't. And there's not even picture styles or movie styles. It's all gray. Sorry, not for me. And he goes, no problem. He gave me the return. They're not supposed to, but he did anyway. And I got some other cameras instead. But it was like, I don't want to. I'm like you. I don't want to spend my life coloring. I don't have time for that.
The thing that I will say about DaVinci. So I got this book on, it was a guidebook on editing. Not color grading, but editing in DaVinci Resolve. And I read it. This was when Doug was really hammering on me. If you're going to do this, you got to do it in Resolve. And what I found was that there was a tremendous amount of thought that had gone into Resolve. Mm-hmm. That they clearly had incorporated the feedback from the highest end colorists and editors. Mm-hmm. And there were things that I'd never even thought about, for example, how you insert into the timeline. And when you want to move the clip, there are half a dozen different ways that you can do that. You can pull it in from one end, you can slide the whole thing mm-hmm. over, and DaVinci, they're just from the get-go. They've thought about this, they've incorporated it. I'm not sure that Final Cut Pro 10 doesn't have this stuff, but I haven't seen it, it's not obvious, and of course, the most telling thing of all is I haven't felt a need to use
right,
it.
Right, right. So, and to me, DaVinci took a lot from Sony Vegas. Especially on the editing timeline side, very similar in some respects. And Vegas was 5 years ahead of everybody, or maybe even 10, back when they came out in editing, in just raw editing, but they never kept up on other things. Now, have you seen Sony Catalyst production? It's not too bad.
It's just... Sony has... I think it's fair to say that Sony has tremendous opportunity to improve the software side of its offerings.
Yeah.
And I think this is really important. Content browser, Catalyst, they just don't get me excited. I don't use them.
They killed the content browser. It's no longer there.
Yeah. There's
so now
there's
you have
no point.
Prepare and edit. That's all.
Yeah. The thing that gets me now about Sony software is their app. The 6300. It is so underwhelming. I think that's a fair thing to say. You can change the shutter speed, you can change the aperture, and you can change the ISO broadly. And that's
better than a lot of them.
Wow, well that's pathetic.
It is pathetic. Try Canon, they're not that good. The only one I found that's pretty good, right? Fuji is so-so, pretty limited. Nikon is like, really? That's all you could do? And Panasonic is the favorite one I've had yet. They do everything. It's really cool how well they control the cameras. Well, you have the GX85.
So I had the GX85. Yeah. I sent it back. I think what I'm going to do next is get the G85 and take a look at that. Because at this point, I think it's not about switching systems. There's too much about Sony that I really love. I don't see abandoning it. I do, however, see adding the next body. So I want three bodies because I want a three-camera shoot for conversations. But I'm edging toward having my third body be Panasonic. And my primary vlogging camera, because the app is so good.
It's nice.
Control tap focus.
Mm-hmm.
But you can also turn on and off manual focus, and you can turn on and off peaking and magnification from the app.
Right.
And that's tremendously different.
Do you like the focus racking? You can touch one object and just drag, and then it automatically focuses smoothly from one to the other?
I am looking forward to trying that out.
It's pretty cool.
When you think about it, though, so let me ask you, what are the scenarios under which you would do a focus pull?
If I'm maybe doing a shot of two people maybe walking, conversing, doing something, I may actually switch from one to the other to get an effect. Or in an interview, I may switch from one to the other to bring one into focus and the other one slightly blurry for the effect. I wouldn't do it that much, but I think it's just cool that you can do it.
So this is the thing, because I don't know, guys, do you feel like you've reached the age where, I'm not going to get all excited. We have a 19-year-old.
Uh-huh.
He wants to cut off the exhaust in his car and then put in a cherry bomb, and then he wants to put in a cold air filter, and it's all good. It's going to add horsepower. It doesn't do a thing except make the car more unreliable, but he's going to have to figure that out on his own. But when it comes to something like touch rack focus, I mean... focus pullers in a theatrical film, are worth their weight in gold.
Oh, sure.
Because what they're doing is they are following the actors and actresses, and they are so familiar with the gearing and the lens that they're using, mm-hmm. that if the actor or actress doesn't hit the mark precisely when and where they're supposed to, the focus puller saves the day.
Mm-hmm.
And my question is, does the touch focus allow you to have that kind of control? In other words, can you slow it down? Can you follow the action? Is it responsive enough and smart enough so that it can follow the action and the speed just with your finger? If it can do that,
I'd say no.
It's extraordinary.
I'd say no, because depending on how you're holding it, or if it's tripod mounted or monopod mounted, you've got to be careful with moving the camera too much. You don't have to hit it hard, but you are touching it. And when you are moving the focus, you're in a 3 or 3.2 inch screen, so you don't have a heck of a lot of room to move.
So that's right.
You're not going to get the timing anywhere near as beautiful as what you get in a motion picture, where they've got the bigger systems. They're not tied to a 3-inch screen with a finger that might be big. I have big hands, so for me it's like... but you can get a simple rack focus. Nothing I would say that would be cinematic. I don't think you could. Maybe you could, but I don't think it'd be easy.
Well, so here you make another point that I just want to share with you guys. So you've got a screen. Let's see here. So here's an A6000 screen, mm-hmm. right? And here is an A7 Plus screen. Let me mm-hmm. move it back. So this way. The A7 Plus is dramatically bigger. But then you've got an iPad Mini.
Well, yeah.
and this is what I'd really like to use to control the camera.
Yep.
And of course, you've got latency issues.
Mm-hmm.
But to be able to swipe across this to get a touch focus, I mean, that's pretty darn interesting.
That would be good. But when you look at the smaller cameras, no. It's just you've just got physics against you. The amount of space, size, it's just not going to work as well.
Here's the physics. My nose. That's the physics. It's a problem.
Yep.
Which is, by the way, why I like this kind of camera with the viewfinder all the way to the left. Mm-hmm.
Yep. And a lot of them aren't. They still keep them right in the middle. So you know you focus with your nose. It's really pretty good. I've done that many times. And of course, a lot of those, the viewfinders are pretty good. Actually, Panasonic's and Sony both have pretty nice EVFs. They're decent. I've seen some. I have no idea why anybody likes a regular viewfinder anymore. It serves to me zero purpose. I can't see exposure. I can't see my shutter speed. Can't see a thing. So to me, the old DSLRs, especially the modern ones that are, they're not even a hybrid. They're just strictly... Well, they are a hybrid. You've got a DSLR, which is digital, and then you've got a normal viewfinder, which serves no real purpose, even though they tell you it does. I haven't seen it. To me, it's useless.
And so you have live view where you can only see it on the rear.
That's right.
Screen, which is ridiculous.
I know.
The thing that we don't talk about often enough is that any of these hybrid cameras are almost useless mm-hmm. outdoors.
They are.
Unless you're holding it to your eye, and that really limits the angles mm-hmm. that you can use. Now, the GX8 has a tiltable or an articulated EVF, but you need a nice big eye cup for it.
Right.
But this is where the FS5, the FS7, I don't like the viewfinders on the C100 or C300 one or two series. But, you know, this is where I'm waiting for a camera manufacturer to reintroduce the right angle finder. Remember those guys?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I'd like to see that.
There are some out there as add-ons to some of the cameras, but they're a little clunky and they don't quite work with. They're third party and you know, you can tell they're not really well integrated.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. Now, this is another reason why the GH5 is interesting to me. This is one of the things that I loved about the Leica SL the very first time I saw it. These viewfinders are EVF, but they're popping some serious megapixels. So the SL is, I think, 4.4 megapixel EVF, and the GH5 is what, guys? Supposed to be 3.6?
I think it's 3.6, I think.
Yeah.
That's a lot, and that's an OLED. That's an OLED, which is clean.
Yeah, I'm excited by that. I would love to see Zacuto, for example. They did the Gradical and the I. Mm-hmm. I would love to see them make an EVF priced for these kind of hybrid cameras. You know, if they could bring it in at $500 or $600.
That'd be cool.
I think they could make a killing, because then you can use these cameras outdoors, put the angle however you want it. The eye is a full HD resolution display. I think that would be a big market for them.
It would. Well, and you know what? Okay, go ahead, Jeff.
I was just going to say, to finish off, I've got one of the first Panasonic HD video cameras with a little LCD flip-out screen, and I can go out in pure great sunlight. I can see everything on that. They did this. It's about nearly getting on to 10 years old, this camera, and I still use it because I can see everything on it. I don't need to do it up to the eye. But I said, if they could do it back then, why can't they do it on the current ones? And the Panasonics after that have got worse and worse. Why can't
they? It's a tough one, and they can. Hugh, this has been a lot of fun. Our half-hour show is now almost an hour. So that was fun. I think we could go on for hours and hours. So we'd love to have you back on.
Well, guys, thanks for inviting me on. This was a lot of fun. You guys know your stuff, and it's just a joy. So thank you.
We're having a good time, too. So we'd love to have you back on and share more. I'd like to talk to you once you get your GH5. We've got some on order, too, and we'll see how much we all like it or not. You never know. The marketing's damn good.
I'll tell you now, Rick, I'm using Hugh as a point of reference now. I'm in the market. I don't know what I want. A GH5. Now he's got me thinking about the Sony after seeing
There he goes again.
6300. I'm going to take his lead. I'm going to see what he thinks about it, because the thing is, all the hype and whatever, nobody's actually got a production one out there. They've all got the copies pre-production that let them out. But I thought, it just sounds too good to be true. So I'm just waiting until somebody gets the proper one and does it in real world situations.
That's true.
I'm going to take Hugh's lead, and I'll really definitely be following him to see what he thinks about it.
You got to watch Jeff. Trust me, Hugh. You got to watch
Rick,
him.
Cause Rick already has the Noctocron. He's already set. So.
I love that Noctocron. That is such a damn nice lens. It really is. It's beautiful, though. On a GH5, the Noctocron now is closer to a 50 millimeter for real.
Is that right? I know you
said that. I think so, because there's no crop.
That's not right.
But they said
it's still a 2x crop.
No, they got rid of the crop. On the GH5, it's now full censored, no crop anymore, which is pretty mind-boggling. Every lens we have is no longer what we think we have because the crop's gone. The 42.5 right now is really more like an 85 millimeter.
That's right.
And it's beautiful, but you're a lot further away. Now it's going to be more like a 50 millimeter at 42.5. That's going to be interesting.
If that's true, that's mind-blowing.
Mind-blowing. Yeah, the 12 to 35 millimeter kit lens, which is actually quite nice, that's going to become a 12 to 35 millimeter kit lens. It won't be a 24 to 70 anymore. So that's going to be very different for all of us. We're going to have to get some new lenses to make up for what we thought we had.
So Leica is coming out with the 12 to 60, right?
That's right. Yep. It's not out yet.
And that's predicated on having a field of view equivalent to a full frame 12 millimeter?
Yeah, that's what they say.
Wow.
That'll be interesting on a Micro Four Thirds.
Wow.
That's going to be cool. We can talk about that another time. Another month, we'll all know.
That's right.
Hugh, this is a real pleasure. We look forward to seeing you again. And hang on for a second. We're going to do our goodbyes, and we'll say goodbye to you, too. All you people watching, thanks for being there. This is Tech Down Over. I'm Rick. I'm joined by Jeff over there in the corner. We had the pleasure of having Hugh Brownstone on today. Hugh, thanks a lot again.
Right back at you. Rick, Jeff, it was great.
Thank you.
Thank you much. And we'll see you next week. Have a good one, everyone.